The following program is a Town of Colonie television production of the William K. Sanford Town Library.
You probably recognize this man, James Michener, shown here on the cover of his 1992 autobiography, published when he was 85, the author of 40 books, including many well-known historical novels. But today I'm going to talk about a book by this man, 37-year-old Lieutenant James Michener, U.S. Navy, a Quaker who volunteered for service in World War II. He was sent to the New Hebrides, a French colony at the time, in 1944, to this base on the island of Espiritu Santo, carved out of the jungle by a battalion of Navy Seabees and, very appropriate to the topic of today's presentation, an infantry company of black soldiers who served as the manual laborers. The military was segregated at that time. On the right, you can see Bomber Field 1. On the left, Bomber 2. Bomber 3 is just out of sight. B-17s took off to bomb Guadalcanal and targets in the Solomons from there. But it was primarily a big Navy supply base. And indeed, Michener was in the Naval Aviation Supply Depot. He supplied manuals to air crews all over the region and did a lot of traveling. Now, wherever he went, he listened to interesting stories told over beers at the transient officers' quarters by pilots and everyone else he met. Late in the war, he decided to write a history of the events that he had seen or heard about. And he began working by the light of a lantern, and there was no electricity at the base, and his Quonset hut every night. He left Espiritu Santo with a manuscript of a book that would change his life. That book was Tales of the South Pacific, a tribute to the men who fought there. It's not a novel in the typical sense. It consists of 19 short stories with a wartime theme, but they were compelling stories. For 30 years, until 1947, the Pulitzer Prize had been awarded to the best novel. In 1948, they changed the category name. Michener's book was awarded a Pulitzer for the best work of fiction, and that remains the category name today. These men, that's composer Richard Rodgers on the left, and lyricist Oscar Hammerstein II on the right in a 1956 photo, they obtained the rights to the book and produced the 1949 musical South Pacific, starring Mary Martin and Ezio Pinza. It ran for 1,925 performances over 4.5 years on Broadway. It won 10 Tony Awards in 1950. It also won the same year the Pulitzer Prize for Drama. In 1958, they produced a movie starring Mitzi Gaynor and Rosano Brazzi. It won only one Oscar, but it was a big commercial success. Now, Michener's book was brought to the attention of Rodgers and Hammerstein by director Josh Logan, who had worked with them earlier. Logan thought that the chapter entitled Fodala would make a good musical. Now, that chapter deals with a Tonkinese woman named Bloody Mary who sells souvenir grass shirts to these GIs for $4. She also sees in Marine Lieutenant Joe Cable the perfect husband for her 16-year-old daughter, Liat. Now, this is a map of the New Hebrides. Today, they are the Republic of Vanuatu. During World War II, Michener's base was located where Luganville is. If you can see on the island, it's labeled Vanuatu. That's actually Espiritu Santo. was located. That is where the musical South Pacific is set. Now, during the war, the French planters sent their wives and daughters to the island of Ambae, which is right there. To keep them away from the Americans. They'd much rather have the Americans there than the Japanese, but they didn't trust them that much. Now, Ambai became Bally High in the musical, the home of Bloody Mary and Liat. It was the name of a small village discovered by Michener one day on patrol in the Solomon Islands. So Rodgers liked the storyline of Fodala, but he did not feel that there was enough there to make a full evening's worth of entertainment, that is, a full musical. So they obtained the rights to the entire book. Now, Rodgers and Hammerstein used material from 6 of the 19 chapters in their musical. Those are the chapters in red here. Chapter 8, our heroine, was about Ensign Nellie Forbush and the French planter Émile Debec. That became the primary romance for the musical. Cable and Liat became the secondary romance. Now, typically at that time at Oklahoma and Carousel, if you know anything about them, the secondary romance was comedy. Will Parker and Addo Annie, who was in a terrible fix because she can't say nix when the boys come to her. But there was no romance here, so they used Navy CB Luther Billis, who appeared in Chapter 9 and Chapter 12 to provide the comedy. And he added more. His role was expanded in Chapter 6, The Milk Run, to include the necessary comedy in the show. Chapter 5, The Cave, describes a dangerous mission that Rodgers and Hammerstein gave to Cable and Debec in order to add drama to the musical. Now, while they're planning the musical, Rodgers got a call from Ezio Pinza's agent. Pinza had just retired from the opera, wanted to star in a musical. Do you have any work for him? As a matter of fact, he did. Rodgers thought that Pinza would be an excellent Émile Debec. But then he needed a Nellie. So he wanted Mary Martin, who was then touring with Annie Get Your Gun. Because she's a Southerner, she was vivacious, she was 21 years younger than Debec as well, than Pinza as well. But she was concerned. I can't sing with Pinza. His voice is overpowering. No one will hear me. Rodgers agreed with her, and he said, we will write it so that you never have to sing at the same time. Oh. And you'll see that a good example of that here. Now, Pinza's English was not too good, but he worked on it. He also was not used to singing 8 times a week, which is the typical Broadway routine. Opera singers once, twice a week, perhaps at most. His voice would go bad, and he missed several performances. He also left after a year to make 2 movies in Hollywood, both according to Rodgers, who was very happy to report, were bombs. But remember, Pinza, along with Martin, won the Tony Award. He was very compelling. And as did Myron McCormick, who played Billis, and Juanita Hall, who played Bloody Mary. The only time to this day that the 4 main awards for acting have gone to one musical. So Mary Martin left after 2 years. But she went to star as Nellie when the production opened on the West End in London. Now, I'm not sure why Mary Martin was not chosen, considered for the 1958 movie. In 1957, she played the role of Nellie on stage in L.A. with Giorgio Tazzi as Debec. It's him shown there on the right. But in the movie, top billing went to Italian star Rosano Brazzi as Debec. However, Rodgers, much to Brazzi's dismay, would not let him sing. So Debec was voiced in the movie by Giorgio Tazzi. Now, Liz Taylor got stage fright during her audition for Nellie and couldn't sing a word, so she was out. Doris Day was deemed ideal for the role, but her husband, who just about bankrupted her after his death, wanted production credit in anything she did, and Rodgers and Hammerstein wouldn't go for that. So Mitzi Gaynor wanted very much the role, and she got it, the role of Nellie. Now, Juanita Hall had sung the role of Bloody Mary on Broadway, but since then, in the 9 years since then, her voice had changed, and they didn't think it was appropriate. So Muriel Smith, shown here, another black American actress, had sung the role of Mary in London. So Juanita Paul played Mary in the movie, but the songs were sung by Muriel Smith. But it wasn't the end for Juanita Hall, because 3 years later in Flower Drum Song, another Rodgers and Hammerstein movie, she did sing on the screen. Ray Walston had played Billis in London. He did his own singing in the movie. And to his left, or to our left there, is Ken Clark, who played Stewpot. Now, this is a creation of Rodgers and Hammerstein. Stewpot never appeared in Michener's book. Stewpot was voiced by Thurl Ravenscroft, who you've never heard of, but you know his work. Or does anybody know who he was? He's the one who sang "You're a Mean One, Mr. Grinch" in the 1966 animated movie. He's also the one that said "They're great." He was Tony the Tiger in the Frosted Flakes commercials. Now, Billis first appears in Chapter 9, Dry Rot, in which Michener so well describes the hardship of being stuck on a single island, a small island, for 27 months. Here is Rodgers and Hammerstein's portrayal. Now, as they start, I want you to notice one thing. The CBs will be pacing back and forth as they sing. That was crafted by Josh Logan. He wanted them to appear like caged animals. Not bad off. There's nothing like a dame.
Yeah.
Okay, there are dames. But like Nellie, all the nurses were commissioned officers. No fraternization allowed between officers and enlisted personnel in the military. Now, this was not only hard on the enlisted men, but it was tough for the nurses, too, because most of the doctors with whom they worked were older and were married. Now, I mentioned they used Chapter 7, the cave. And Chapter 7 has two storylines, one of which was used. First, I want to talk briefly about the one that they didn't use, because there are a couple of interesting points. As you see Guadalcanal here in the bottom, and the Florida islands, including right here an island, Tulagi. Now, this takes place in 1942, this part of it. On August 7th, 1942, the Marines went ashore on Guadalcanal to take back the field that they were building, it's Henderson Field, you can see there, from the Japanese, before they could use it to bomb Espirito Santo and everywhere else. So, and they took part of the island, and from then on, until the Japanese finally gave up and evacuated or pulled out on February 1943, there were some terrible battles there. So every day, they would send bombers down to bomb the Marines around the installations, and every night, they would send destroyers into what now is Iron Bottom Sound. It was a Sealar Channel then, to either provide more troop supplies or to come in and shell the Marines around the fields. So the at Tulagi in the Michener's story is a PT boat squadron. And it talks about how every night they go out, they were 80-foot wooden boats armed with torpedoes to go out and fight the destroyers to keep the Japanese out because the U.S. Navy would come in and try to stop them. Now, every name you see there is a ship that was sunk during those 8 months or from the bay. 19 Japanese boats and 33 American ships. Terrible night fighting. So one of the things I want to mention is that the squadron was actually there. One of the boats in the squadron was PT-109, but John F. Kennedy did not arrive until April 1943 after the Japanese had evacuated. However, then it moved west to the Russell Islands. It was in the Russell Islands just west of Guadalcanal that PT-109 was rammed by a destroyer and story taken. The other thing I want to mention is that on November 12th, 1942, the U.S. was providing supplies, the ships were anchored, providing supplies for the Marines on shore when they were attacked by Japanese dive bombers. And a pilot of a Japanese dive bomber that had been hit and was going to crash, deliberately crashed his plane into the cruiser USS San Francisco. It crashed into a gun turret, which was firing at him to the last second, killing the entire crew. I mention that because the man who was, the sailor was manning that gun and died in the impact was Frank Slater, a seaman from Alabama. The destroyer escort USS Slater at the port is named after him. All right, the other story, the one that they did use involves coast watchers. And in this case, there really were. When they went ashore, the Australians had, and the British had, people who lived on the islands, and they were providing movements, reports by a radio that they had to the Australians regarding Japanese movements of ships and planes. So when they went ashore, the Marines landed on Guadalcanal, and that's Guadalcanal. They would report planes flying from Rabaul, which is up above Bougainville there. The CW is a coast watcher on Bougainville. They would provide planes coming south, the number, the type, and the ships as well. That gave the U.S. Air crews on Guadalcanal time to get up, get off the ground, and meet them. And it made a big difference. So Michener's story includes a coast watcher. In his story, at the torpedo squadron on Tulagi, a Navy officer comes ashore and brings radio equipment and goes into a cave that the Japanese had dug while they were there. And he starts receiving reports from a coast watcher up on Bougainville called the Remittance Man. The Remittance Man, Michener met when he was in Samoa. These were the sons of wealthy British families who received remittances each month to live on. Now, they wouldn't have gone far in the south of France, but in the South Pacific, you could live like a king. So this coast watcher, he called him the Remittance Man, who sent in reports of movements every day until one day it stopped. The Japanese had caught and executed him. Now, Rodgers and Hammerstein thought that that would be an excellent role for Cable. It wasn't in Mitchell's story, and DeBeck would go with him. So that's where they added drama to this. Now for the primary romance. Richard Rodgers described Nellie's songs as just like her, colloquial, direct, sunny, and youthful. Emile's songs, on the other hand, were sophisticated, romantic, and philosophical. Here is Nellie's description of herself. She describes herself to DeBeck, a cockeyed optimist. There's an obvious attraction there, but they're so different in age and background. Both of them wonder what is there in me that the other person, you know, she would see or what he would see in me. Here's an example of a duet in which Nellie and Emile do not sing at the same time. Is that okay?
This is what I long for, someone young and smiling, lining up my
ear. We are not alike, probably I'm born. He's a cultured Frenchman, I'm a little pig.
Younger men than I, officers and doctors, probably pursue her. She could have her pick.
Thank you.
now we'll meet Bloody Mary in the beginning of the secondary romance. Here's Bloody Mary as she was described by the Seabees. You'll also see the arrival of Lieutenant Joe Cable. There's Mary's son-in-law, so she thinks. Bloody Mary, it's interesting. You don't see it in the movie, but the reality about it is she was from Tonkin, 80 miles north of Hanoi. You probably remember those of the Vietnam War, the Tonkin Gulf Resolution. So that was the area of northern what's Vietnam. She lived 80 miles north. When Michener met a Tonkinese, and they were all indentured servants. They came to work for the French plantations and made a lot of money and went home rich. But they were signed for 3 years. The problem is, when the war broke out, the French wouldn't let them go back home, and that was okay. They understood, but they were kept at the same pay rate. So they were very much experienced. So that's one of the reasons Bloody Mary was selling souvenirs, you know, because she didn't make more money than she could working on the plantation. At any rate, the so when he arrives there, Joe Cable sees the island offshore. And asks her what it is. Now, the truth is that Michener never knew what it meant, but Bloody Mary knew what it meant. It means your special island. And of course, she wants to get him over there. That's where Liat lives. So we're going to see Bloody Mary singing Bally High, part of it. And I know you're going to wonder, you'll be asking yourself, why did cinematographer Leon Shamroy use so many colored filters in the movies? Many have asked, no one knows. Certainly the setting was nice enough, he didn't need it, but he did that. So here's a good part of Bally High.
Long for another island. One
So Cable's intrigued, but he has other work to do. He's on a mission, so the secondary romance is put on hold. He checks in with the base commander, tells him why he's there. His colonel, I should say, Cable's in from Guadalcanal, and his colonel there thinks that they need a coast watcher on an island to monitor the, give us an advantage monitoring the Japanese. So, but he can't go alone. He needs someone with experience. He knows there's a Frenchman, Emile de Beck, down here on Espirito Santo, who is hunted up there, and he needs him as a guide. But he needs first to check him out. Needs to know, what his background is, and also what his politics are. Now, what his politics are. Very interesting topic during the war. If you were French, and especially in the colonies, your politics were one of two diverse things. You were a fan of Marshal Pétain on the left, of Vichy France, a Nazi sympathizer and collaborator who ran the southern part of France for the Nazis and collaborated with them, or Charles de Gaulle of the Free French, an arrogant man, but a man who advocated liberty for all. So that was very important, and they needed to know which side was he on. Now, we're out of sequence here. So anyway, Nelly, they know that Nelly has a relationship with de Beck, so they call her in and ask her what she knows about him. She doesn't know much. We need you to spy on him, in essence, find out these questions. For they'd heard he killed a man and had to leave France for that way, the story, and also what his politics are. So later, Nelly runs into, after she gets a letter from her mom back in Little Rock, and asks Cable, would you go, if you had a sister, would you let her go out with an older man? You mean like de Beck? Yes. No, I wouldn't. Forget de Beck. Of course, he wants de Beck to go with him. He doesn't need competition for Nelly. So Nelly decides to take his advice. Oops, I don't know what happened here. But anyway, take his advice and wash de Beck right out of her hair. This movie was shot in Princeville on the north shore of Kauai, 1958. Hawaii wasn't even a state. She said the first time they did the scene, she had to quit. The shampoo got in her eyes. So someone drove 30 miles to the nearest store in the little village of Lihue, found a bottle of Johnson baby shampoo, and brought it back, another 30. She said with that, she did the scene. They shot it in one take, and it was done. So here is Nellie after she decides to let de Beck go. De Beck, after questioning her about that strange American song she was singing, tells her he's come to invite her to a party. And of course, just having washed him out of her hair, oh no, I can't do that. It's a big party. You won't miss me. But it's for you. It's in honor of you. I want you to meet all the other French planters. I want you to know what plantation life would be like. He also asked her to marry him. And she is hesitant, but then she remembers the question she's supposed to ask, and indeed questions about his background and his political views. She likes his answer, agrees to go to the party, and when she's razzed by the other nurses, she responds in song with a wonderful guy.
One of my crowd to make fun of my proud protestations of faith and romance. And they'll say I'm naive as a babe to believe any fable I hear from a person in pants.
Now, De Beque, based on the information obtained by Nelly, has passed muster, and he's asked to go with Kibbe to the island. Very dangerous. He's a civilian. It's up to him. But he has to weigh the danger very carefully. For now, he has Nelly in his life, and he refuses to go along. Without De Beque, Kibbe has no mission. He's told to take a couple days off, get a boat, and go fishing. Then he remembers Bally High and goes there with Billis. I want you to notice Kibbe has no shirt on. I'll explain the significance of that later. Billis never had a shirt on, even in Michener's book, and a ring at his ear. Real character. So they're approaching Bally High. Stop there and move on. You notice the ladies on the left side of the screen in white? Those are the daughters and wives of the French planters. Also, I'd heard when I was researching that somewhere on that dock is Ava Gardner in a cameo. Haven't spotted her yet. So there to go to the Boristus ceremony. Bloody Mary is there and takes Cable up to the hut to meet Liat. Here's Joe Cable's tribute to Liat.
Like a pair of birds that burst with song. My eyes look down at your lovely face.
On Broadway, Joe Cable comes into the hut where Liat is wearing a shirt. And they embrace and the lights go down. When the lights come back up, they're still embraced and his shirt is off. That's fine on Broadway, but not in a movie. Hence, no shirt on the way in.
Did John Kerr sing his own?
No, he did not. Excellent question. And I think his name was pronounced like Deborah, spelled K-E-R-R, pronounced like that, but no relation. Thurl Ravenscroft, who's the one that had the deep voice, he had a vocal group, and one of the guys in the group was Bill Lee. He's the one who voiced John Kerr. That's an excellent question. And
it sounds like his voice.
Does it?
It sounds like the actor's.
Yeah. He gave up acting in 1970, went to law school, and became an attorney for actors, did very well. Liat is played by France Nguyen, the common Vietnamese name. She was from Marseille, Vietnamese father, French mother. And she became a clinical psychologist and had a practice. So they both got out of the business. Cable has fallen for Liat in a big way, in Michener's story and here. But he has strong misgivings about their relationship. Meanwhile, Nellie has had a wonderful time at the party, but she is in for a big surprise afterwards. Here is a surprise for Nellie.
Oh, why, you're the cutest things I ever saw in my whole life. What are your names? You probably can't understand a word I'm saying, but oh my goodness, you're cute.
Nellie, I wanted to meet Gavin Giraud. Gavin Giraud. Nellie.
Nelly?
Nelly? Colonie, Vic. Vic, eh?
Bonsoir, Nelly.
Aren't they adorable? Those big black eyes staring at you out of those sweet little faces. Are they Henry's?
Never mind.
Oh, of course they are. They look exactly like you, don't they? Where do you have their mother?
She's dead, Nelly.
Thank you.
Emil, they are yours.
Yes, madam. I'm their father.
And their mother was a...
Polynesian. She was beautiful, very.
Okay. Nellie hadn't known anything about the children, let alone the fact that they had a Polynesian mother. Nellie was raised in the South, where people were white, yellow, or black, but it wasn't stated in those terms. Now, DeBeck has lived with a black woman, and she cannot marry a man who's done that. The hardest part for her is telling DeBeck why she can't marry him. To avoid having to face him, she asks for a transfer. Now, the transfer is denied because she, along with Billis, are the heart and soul of the Thanksgiving show, and she must perform there. Now, at the same time, Joe Cable has incurred the wrath of Bloody Mary by telling her while he loves Liotta, he can't marry her. His upbringing will simply not allow it. Now, he describes this upbringing to, Nellie in our next song, My Girl Back Home.
My girl back home, I'd almost forgot. A blue-eyed kid, I liked her a lot. We got engaged. Families were glad, and I was told by my uncle and dad that if I were clever and able, they'd make me a part of the partnership. Cable, Cable, and Cable. How far away, Philadelphia, PA, Princeton, MJ, how far they? From coconut palms and banyan trees and coral sands and Tonkinese. NJ, how far are they?
How far are they?
From coconut palms and banyan trees and coral sands and...
DeBeck has heard that Nellie has asked for a transfer, wants to know why. She's trying to avoid him. Nellie can't give him a good reason why she won't marry him, or why she feels that way. It was born in me, she shouts, and then runs off to the officers' club. Now the next song gets to the crux of the issue in both of these relationships. It's not born in you. You've got to be carefully taught.
You. It happens after you're born.
You've got to be taught to hate and fear. You've got to be taught from year to year. It's got to be drummed in your dear little ear. You've got to be carefully taught. You've got to be taught to be afraid of people whose eyes are oddly made, and people whose skin is a different shade. You've got to be carefully taught. You've got to be taught before it's too late. Before you are 6 or 7 or 8, to hate all the people your relatives hate, you've got to be carefully taught. You've got to be carefully taught.
You got the right idea, dear Beck. Live on an island. Yes, sir. If I get out of this thing alive, I'm not going back there.
Very significant. So Cable's decided to stay there and marry Leon. But he will have to stay because he cannot take her home to Philadelphia. No Princeton man from a Philadelphia mainline family with a future in a family law firm would bring home a bride that he had found living in a hut on a primitive island. A man of quality would simply never choose anyone like that. And it was demeaning to even suggest this in any piece of drama. This was a very controversial topic in 1949. And as Michener said, there was a significant minority that wanted them to drop the whole relationship from the show. But the one man who refused to do it, believed very strongly about in talking about prejudice, was Oscar Hammerstein. He refused, even if it became a commercial failure, which it obviously wasn't, he refused to do it. He stood up for what he believed in. So Cable now has what he wants, but everything DeBeck wants has been taken from him. So he then agrees to go on the mission with Cable. They are dropped on the island. They do provide valuable information. The tide is turning. Now, Nellie does not know that DeBeck has gone on the mission. But she hears the wounded pilots at the hospital where she works talking about the Frenchman this and how the information he's providing is turning the tide and how long can they last up there in that Japanese-held island. So she goes to the commander and said, this Frenchman, is this my Frenchman? Indeed it is. And while she's there, he checks in on the radio and has to report that his friend Joe Cable has been killed, that he has to end the thing abruptly because the Zeros are looking for him. And the call ends. So she is very distraught. She knows that she made a mistake, and she wants DeBeck back. She wills him to survive the mission and come back to her. He does survive and is with DeBeck's children at the plantation when he returns home. Technical difficulties. We are going to have a different ending, just as good. I haven't heard the song that I've been listening to for 50 years, but I only learned about 20 years ago that Rodgers and Hammerstein wrote it. We're going to finish with a song. Here is Some Enchanted Evening.
You may see a stranger.
Never rise. Some enchanted evening.
Thank you for bearing with me. Hope you enjoyed it.